Hadrian was the 14th Roman emperor from 117 to 138 AD. He is known as one of the five good emperors, such as Nerva, Trajan, Hadrian, Antoninus Pius, and Marcus Aurelius. Hadrian is most famous for his grand building projects throughout Rome. He is also supposedly known for his gay relationship with a man named Antoninus. Let's talk about his early life. Hadrian's original name was Publius Aulus Hadrianus. He was born on January 24th, 76 AD. Hadrian's ancestors left Picenum, Italy, for southern Spain around 250 years before he was born. His father was from Italica, and his mother was from Gades. It is unclear where Hadrian was born. Some historians say it was his father's hometown in Italica, and others say he was born in Rome. In 85 AD, when Hadrian was just 10 years old, his father died. It was a Roman tradition for a male guardian to be appointed when a child's father dies. In this case, it was a cousin of his father, and later to be Emperor Trajan, and Acilius Antoninus, who would later serve as prefect of Emperor Hadrian's Praetorian Guard early in his reign. Trajan was a highly respected general. When Hadrian was old enough, he went with Trajan on military campaigns. Hadrian learned some form of military training and adopted a hobby of hunting. In 91 AD, Hadrian began his career as a Roman senator. He rose through the ranks and was military tribune with three Roman legions. For those that don't know, a Roman tribune was an opening of a senatorial career by the order of the emperor's nomination. In 95 AD, Hadrian served with Augustus' second legion in the province of Upper Mosia on the Danube River, and the year after he was transferred to Lower Mosia with the 5th Macedonian Legion. By the end of 97 AD, Hadrian was selected to travel west to Gaul to welcome Trajan, who had just been adopted as Emperor Nerva's successor. In 98 AD, Julius Servianus, Hadrian's brother-in-law, tried to stop Hadrian from being the first to notify Trajan of Nerva's death. Servianus would continue to pose a threat to Hadrian's career. Luckily for Hadrian, he had some powerful friends. Lucius Licinius Sura, a well-known Roman senator, was the man behind Trajan's rise to power, and as long as Sura lived, he would be quite useful for Hadrian as well. Trajan's wife Plotina can be seen close to Sura as well, and a strong supporter of Hadrian. In 100 AD, Hadrian married Trajan's grandniece, Vibia Sabina, and in 101 AD, Hadrian was made quaestor. In 102 AD, Hadrian accompanied Trajan for the emperor's first war in Dacia on the Danube. In 105 AD, Hadrian became a tribune of the plebs, also known as tribune of the people. It had no military function and was a powerful political office. The tribune was meant to help the people and had the power to veto. In 106 AD, Hadrian rose to praetorship, where he held extensive administrative authority. As praetor, Hadrian served Emperor Trajan in the second war in Dacia. In 107 AD, Hadrian was governor of Lower Pannonia for a short time. In 108 AD, Hadrian reached the peak of a senator's career, the consulate. Sometime after Hadrian's consulate, Licinius Sura died. This would be devastating, as Hadrian's political career came to a halt for nearly 10 years. It is possible that a new political opposition appeared that took control of the majority of Trajan's court. It is also possible that Julius Servianus played a part in this, but that cannot be confirmed. As for what Hadrian was doing in his inactive years, this might shine a light on things. A surviving inscription was found in the Theater of Dionysus. It was there to honor Hadrian as Archon at Athens. In 112 AD, an Archon was a chief judge that ruled over a city-state or multiple city-states. Even though he was in a time of political inactivity, his devotion to the Greeks was an indication of what he was to become as emperor. Even though Hadrian's missing years cloud his history a bit, he did make it back into the emperor's favor before he died. That is clear. In 117 AD, Trajan was on campaign in Cilicia, and Hadrian was left in charge of the army in Syria. On August 9th, Hadrian supposedly heard that he was adopted by Trajan, and on the 11th, it was reported that Trajan died while on his way back to Rome. The Roman army then proclaimed Hadrian as emperor. Trajan's adoption of Hadrian is a little strange. Rumors of a conspiracy appeared involving Trajan's wife Plotina. It is claimed that she signed the papers of Hadrian's succession, and it was her decision to make Hadrian emperor. We will never know if this is fact, But seeing how Hadrian had close ties to Trajan throughout his career, Plotina's conspiracy may only be a rumor. Hadrian, now as emperor, slowly made his way back to Italy, as he still needed to attend to his previous provincial commands. The conquests in both Armenia and Mesopotamia that were started by Trajan were abandoned. The earlier mentioned Acilius Atanius was made prefect of the Praetorian Guard. He would be in charge of the affairs before Hadrian returned. He orders the execution of 4 senators that seem to be a threat to Hadrian. Now, this is not the picture you want to paint as the new emperor. He blamed Atanius, as this was not what he wanted. In the summer of 118 AD, Hadrian made it back to Rome and was still in a good position. In order to gain more support, Hadrian put on public acts of kindness. He put on gladiatorial spectacles and a formal cancellation of debts to the state. Atanius was removed as prefect, replacing him with the once honorable general Marcus Tubo and Septicus Clarus, the supporter of the biographer Suetonius. Hadrian stayed in Rome for 3 years, and in 121 AD, Hadrian set out on a journey to explore the Roman Empire, to inspect the soldiers and their defenses. He traveled to Gaul, Germany, and Britain in 122 AD, moving on to Spain. Spain would be Hadrian's last visit to the western provinces. Later, Hadrian spent the winter in Tetico, now known as Tarragona, in the Catalonia region. It is there that he made plans for dealing with a revolt in Morocco. He then passed through the Balkans, where he negotiated some problems with the Parthians, and after, went to the northwestern Asia Minor. It is important to note that in 123 AD, Hadrian thought of his reign as a new Augustan age, based on the first emperor of Rome, Augustus. This is also the time Hadrian called himself Hadrianus Augustus. Basically, Hadrian was influenced by Augustus. On his coinage, he proclaimed a golden age of peace that he always wanted, the next Augustan peace. Even in his speech of accomplishments, it was similar to Augustus's. Moving on, in 124 AD, Hadrian returned to the west coast, and in 125 AD, made it back to Rome. Hadrian only spent another 3 years in Rome, and set out in 128 AD to Africa. You could see Hadrian as an explorer in a way. After his visit to North Africa, he went to Athens. From there, he sailed to the Asia Minor, in Bithynian Quadrupolis, known as modern-day Bolo, in the northwestern Asia Minor. Hadrian meets the young Atinuus, born around 110 AD. Something about Atinuus interests Hadrian, and he made him his companion. They both traveled to Syria and Arabia, eventually crossing over to Egypt. Unfortunately, when Hadrian and Atinuus journeyed down the Nile River, Atinuus was said to have drowned. Hadrian's reaction to Atinuus' death was clear. Statues of the youth were common, and cults of Atinuus appeared in the east and later came to the west. Hadrian named a city in Egypt, Anthropolis, to honor his death. It is claimed that Atinuus was Hadrian's lover, but I'll get into that in a sec. According to the ancient Roman historian Dio Cassius, who was born in 150 AD, thought Antinous offered himself as a sacrifice. While doing my research for Hadrian, I found a couple of sources and articles stating that Hadrian and Antinous were lovers, as an absolute fact. Now you can see the problem with this, because we weren't there to witness the events take place. Evidence does lead in that direction. Hadrian had no heirs, but Nerva and Trajan had no heirs as well. It is obvious Hadrian cared for Atinuus, to the point he had him deified. That is pretty interesting, but there is always the chance that it isn't true. Let me pose a theory for an example. Atinuus drowned under Emperor Hadrian's supervision. Just imagine the backlash Hadrian would have gotten as emperor, so he had him deified to please all sides and to ease his own guilt. Atinuus could have been a sacrifice. He also could have reminded Hadrian of his younger self. All these are possibilities, but they can't be stated as if they're facts. In my opinion, this part of Hadrian's life should be left in the realm of possibilities. After Hadrian's gloomy trip to Egypt, he went back to Athens for his third visit. It is not clear when Hadrian returned to Rome, possibly in 132 AD, but he was there in May 134 AD. It wasn't long after that he was forced to make in what was to be his final journey because of a revolt in Judea, a small province of the Roman Empire in Palestine. Before we get into Hadrian's final journey, let's talk about some of his artistic accomplishments. Hadrian was a poet later in life. 4 complete poems of his have been found. Apparently, it was reported that Hadrian had a dispute with a lead architect named Apollodorus of Damascus. It is even said Hadrian had the architect executed. Hadrian's Wall in North Britain was one of his most famous architectural accomplishments. The project started sometime around 122 AD, linking his visit to Britain. The wall was known in ancient times as Vallium Hadriani. The wall stretched from coast to coast and was built in 6 years by the legion's position in Britain. A possible reason for its construction was to show the true power of the Roman Empire. I guess you could say Hadrian created peace through might. In Athens, Greece, the Arch of Hadrian, constructed in 131 AD, was to honor Hadrian's arrival and to thank him for helping out the city. Just outside of Rome, in Tivoli, is another masterpiece of Hadrian. Hadrian's villa, built in 125 to 134 AD. The villa included baths, libraries, sculpture gardens, theaters, dining halls, pavilions, and private suites. It stands as a prime example of what luxury the Roman world could bring. In Rome, Hadrian completely rebuilt the Pantheon, which was destroyed by a fire in Trajan's reign. Hadrian's great tomb, known as the Castel Sant'Angelo, was built in 135 to 109 AD on the right bank of the Tiber River. The tomb was inspired by the mausoleum of Augustus. Interesting fact, Hadrian's mausoleum was converted into a fortress in the 5th century. Now for our last segment, Hadrian's final years. In 134 AD, Hadrian left Rome for his final journey. His goal was to solve the problems in the part of Judea. At the time, the Jewish people were rebelling under the leadership of Bar Kokhba. But the reason for the revolution isn't known. Jewish texts mention a prosecution under the reign of Hadrian, which led the Jews to fear for their lives, some abandoning their religion. It is possible that Hadrian's universal ban on circumcision around 130 AD was the cause. Hadrian's hatred of mutilation got to the point that he stated castration was comparable to murder. I doubt Hadrian wanted to anger the Jewish people. The revolution was understandable if that was the case. Hadrian appointed his general, Sextus Julius Severus, to fix the problem. 1 year after Hadrian's visit, the revolts ended. Recent discoveries show that the measures to stop the revolts were severe, but they were dated to take place 6 years and earlier, possibly ruling out circumcision as the cause. In 135 AD, no horrific punishments were dealt by Hadrian. In 134 AD, Hadrian's lifetime rival, Julius Servianus, held the consular office for his third term. However, he was too old, so he may have seen his grandson, Fuscus, as the next emperor. But that was put to an end when they were both executed in 136 AD. Hadrian, now an aged emperor, had to make a decision that all previous emperors have made. Who would succeed him? Possibly out of desperation, he chose Lucius Caonius Commodus, a senator around 35 years old. He also had no military experience. As emperor, he was known as Lucius Aelius Caesar. Caonius had a promising future, but he became sick and died on January 1st, 138 AD. It is thought that he died from tuberculosis, a common disease in ancient times. Hadrian's next choice was an 18-year-old boy named Annius Verus, later known as the famous Marcus Aurelius. Hadrian wanted to adopt Verus as his successor, but he was still pretty young, so he adopted an aged senator, Antoninus Pius, to succeed him. But there was a catch. He would have to adopt the young Verus and the son of Caonius, so his father would be remembered. Interesting enough, the first emperor Augustus made similar requirements for Tiberius. Adopting Antoninus as emperor was meant to give Verus and Caonius' son an early rule, as it was thought Antoninus had very little time left. But just like Tiberius, Antoninus lived longer than expected, dying in 161 AD. Hadrian died at the seaside resort of Baiae in 138 AD, at the age of 62. It is thought that he died from a heart attack, as reported by Dio Cassius. The cause of death can be supported in Hadrian's statue. It shows bilateral, diagonal ear creases. Many scientists link the ear creases to coronary artery diseases. Basically, it is caused by the collapse of blood vessels in the earlobe. Just one of the symptoms, though. But then again, that may be a bit much coming from a statue. Hadrian's body was first buried at Puteoli on the grounds of the former estate of Cicero to honor his passion for learning. 1 year later, Hadrian's body was cremated and his ashes were sent to the tomb of Hadrian, which was now complete. Antoninus had Hadrian deified and built temples to honor him. Although Hadrian was not admired during his reign or just after his death, he did uphold an empire of relative peace through power and knowledge. Thanks for watching. I know this video took 3 weeks to make. It was unexpected. I hope you understand it was a big topic to take on. Anyways, what do you guys think of Hadrian? Would you consider him one of the greatest emperors? Let me know in the comments below. If you liked the video, make sure to leave a like. It really helps me out. If you haven't already, subscribe for more history content, and I'll see you guys in the next video.